Welcome everyone. We're gonna get started in just a minute. If you wanna wave, turn on your camera, come on in. Welcome to say hi. Hello, Robert. Okay. Nice to see y'all. If it's your first field trip, you can DM me or just like say hi to everyone and let us know. Your 20th field trip, you can do the same thing. Everyone, we're excited for everyone here. This is a remix of a song that I love and I didn't realize it would be so chill, but we're just rolling with it. We'll get started in just a minute. Hello, Ron. Is there ever a flattering angle of the past? Yeah, no need to have your camera on, Taylor. It's all good. What do your best impression of yourself? The tasteful adaptation of your living hell. And those who tell you what you are, see an insect in a jar and put it on your name tag. In plain. All right, friends, we've got our quorum here. So we're gonna get started. If you've been to a field trip, you know we do a little intro, which is just to say, I'm Alexa, I am your field trip support person for today. If you have any tech questions or anything that you're not sure if it's appropriate to share in the chat, you can direct message those to me. Field trip recordings are shared for 72 hours on demand after the field trip, as long as you're registered. So that is a new thing that we're very excited about. Let me see other tech things. That's it, except that field trips, as y'all know, are just as much learning experiences for the hosts as they are for us. So I'm gonna invite, there's 100 people in this room. So I just want to invite y'all for only a moment to turn your cameras on if you would like, so that we can give Dr. Benjamin Ritter some jazz hands and give ourselves some sparkles and just like we're virtual, we're here, but we're also all people and you all have very special faces. So we're just gonna do like a screen confetti. That's what we call it. I just made that up. So screen confetti for Benjamin. 3, 2, 1. Look at all those faces. So good to see everyone. Okay, Benjamin, please take it away. Thank you, screen confetti friends.
Oh, that was magical. Thank you so much, everyone. And I guess if anything resonates with you, feel free to do some confetti or just type confetti in the chat if you can't turn your camera on. Thank you, Alexa. That was wonderful. Okay. Share my screen for everyone. Because I can't always be looking in the chat, so I won't get to see that amazing screen confetti or with your cameras, we're going to be using a tool called Slido today for just some engagement that I'll be able to see a little bit more clearly, as well as for everyone as well to share their thoughts anonymously. So if you've never used Slido before, you can either use your phone to scan this QR code. It will take you right to the Slido poll that we're about to launch, as well as Alexa through the link and the key code in the chat that you can enter through a web browser. So the instructions will stay up on the screen as I go to the next slide, so don't worry, as well as they're in the chat. But I'm curious, and I think a lot of other people are curious, what brings you here today? I love this question whenever I host an event. You tend to see that some people are here for the same reason, some people are here for different reasons, but there's usually a general theme. It helps me, right, understand what you're here for, but also I think it helps bring people together. Helps you normalize what you're going through and what you're feeling. So let's see what we have. Professional crossroads, curious about changing jobs, just want to learn, stuck, not sure where to begin, curious, stagnating at work, not sure where to go next, don't know what my dream job is, need a job, so a dream would be nice, confused about what I want to change my career, job change, curiosity. I think we're all in the right place. This is good. Create clarity. Thank you. If you've heard of a talk of mine before, I'm happy that you're here. Thank you. I'm missed the job search right now. I really want to find something that feels better. Still looking for a career fit. What's new and discover your dream job? Yeah, what is the top of the hour research? There are some things that are going to stay the same and some things that might adjust based on the current market needs. Okay, so thank you all for sharing. I just kind of wanted to get a light feel and temperature of everyone in the room today. And this is how we use Slido. So if you haven't used it before, feel free to use it in your own presentations for engagement, but also we'll be having some other questions in the future. So this was a good warm up. My name is Dr. Benjamin Ritter. By the way, I founded Live for Yourself Consulting back in 2016. I'm a leadership and career coach. I'm also the head of talent development at a life sciences manufacturing organization where I create basically talent development programs to help people fall in love with their job and to develop into their dream job. I speak around the world. I have a couple podcasts, but ultimately I'm here because I'm passionate about helping others create a career that they love. Ultimately, we all have a professional superpower within us, and I love unlocking that either in your current job or in finding a new job. If you like what I'm saying today, please connect with me on LinkedIn. You can find out more about what I do at liveforyourselfconsulting.com. But I got here today, through my own career journey. I was stuck. I woke up in a cloud of resentment and negativity towards my job. I was working in healthcare. I was there for about 5-6 years, and it was basically going into work not to work. I don't know if you can resonate with that. Please feel free to throw a yes in the chat, because it was a tough time. I would sneak out during lunch to go to the gym. I would try to get there late. I'd try to leave early. I would purposely not volunteer for work. I would really try not to connect with people. People would try to have conversations with me, and I'd try to keep it professional and also try to end the conversation early because I was so busy. I ultimately was seen as an actual good worker. I was promoted. I was selected for leadership training programs, but mentally I was severely disengaged and I was not creating bridges. I was probably burning them. And I was basically wasting my life. I was wasting my career. I wasn't building career capital. And I was lucky. I was one of the lucky ones, I think, on the way when I was walking to work. By the way, I could walk to work. That's when we would go into work, most of us. But I was walking into work and looked around, and it just seemed like every single person that I touched eyes with felt the same way, had this like sense of dread within themselves. They were kind of like these walking zombies. And I had this come to moment, say, why am I doing this to myself? What is the reason why I'm creating this environment? And now what can I do to change it? And so that led for myself to craft my job, to discover my dream job, went back up my doctorate in organizational leadership, founded a new company, and now work in the talent development organizational culture space, as well as run my own business. It was my own journey. I've learned a lot from it. I studied, well, how can we help others craft their own journey? And so that's where I've come from. And hopefully you can resonate with that. Hopefully maybe if you've been in this space, you can see that other people have been there too. And it is possible to make a change. I've worked with a variety of companies since then, big to small and all across the industry. So if you're sitting here thinking, well, he hasn't worked in my industry. Well, I promise you, I've worked probably in your industry with clients that have been there. And the same concepts and theories and activities and suggestions I'm going to make today will relate to you, will relate to where you're at in your career. They are foundational. And so let's drop that potential limiting belief, that excuse to say, I'm not going to listen, and just come to this event, this workshop, with an open heart and open mind. Now, if you do like what I'm saying today, check me out. I have a couple podcasts out there. Again, connect with me on LinkedIn. There's a special gift for everyone that does. You can scan these QR codes after you watch the recording to get taken directly to the podcast, or just look them up on iTunes. The first one, the Live for Yourself Revolution, is basically exploring stories of people that are living for themselves. And the Executives is about the career paths of executives. How do you continue growing in your career as a leader? And how do you develop as a leader? So today we're going to talk about your commitment to the job search, to finding your dream job. We're going to talk about the main myths that tend to hold people back. I just kind of hinted at one of those excuses that we tend to tell ourselves. We're going to discuss the career sweet spot. If you've been to one of my events before, I talk about this endlessly. It is critical and important. So if you haven't done the work, hopefully do the work today. Discuss, well, what do you do with this information? How do you take next steps to discover that dream job or to start exploring that dream job? There'll be a raffle for everyone and a free gift and some time for a Q&A. Most importantly, please get a pen and paper or open up a Word document so you can take notes. Be prepared for some Slido questions later on and use the chat. I see that that's going right now. I have an incredible helper today, Alexa, who's going to be taking your questions and collating them into a document. So if you put it in the chat, it will be seen. So two of the main situations that I see that hold job seekers back are exemplified by these quotes. So I'd like you to take a second and read them. I'm going to read them out loud too. But this, you might fall into one of these categories. So the first one, the worst thing one can do is to not try. To be aware of what one wants and not give into it. To spend years in silent hurt wondering if something could have materialized, never knowing. So this is where you have a hint of what you want to do, but you don't want to act. You can't just bring yourself to try. I don't know if you fall into that bucket. If you do, throw it in the chat. Now, the other situation is that you're aware of that there's something more is out there for your career. You feel it in your gut. You know that you're in the wrong place. And you sit in that discomfort day in and day out. But you choose to not explore the possibilities for whatever reason. And those can be very valid reasons, but you're making a choice not to explore. If that resonates with you, throw it in the chat. And so these two main situations are that you know and you're not trying, or that you don't know and you're choosing not to try. But ultimately, the underlying current here is that we're not taking action, that we're not trying. Now, you all are here today. So that is an action step forward. And it sounds like you're also, if you're here today, you're probably doing something else too. You may or may not be. But what I ask from all of you, and going back to Slido for a second, is can you make a commitment to trying from this day on? I have found with working with clients over the years that if you consistently make a commitment to try, that it will work out. It may take some time, right? Getting a coach, reading, listening to podcasts, going to these types of workshops can speed up the process. But that's what it does. It speeds up the process. It doesn't, you can still be successful just by committing to trying. Now, for myself personally, I mean, my transition from healthcare to my business took 3 years. Now, before that too, out of grad school, I went to grad school. I got a joint MBA and MPH. And for 2.5 years out of grad school, I didn't get a full-time job. I had 4 job offers in what I thought was my dream job get canceled from me. Get pulled. I got the written job offer, signed on the dotted line, submitted it in. Right before I was supposed to start work, those jobs got canceled. But I didn't stop trying. And there actually was a point where I almost did, where I woke up in bed one day and said, what am I doing? I've stopped being consistent. I stopped being intentional. And so I restarted trying. If you can wake up each and every single day intentionally focused on creating a dream job, finding this next step in your career, I promise you that things will fall into place because you are serving yourself. You are serving your commitment, that things will work out. But there's a lot of tools to help us speed up that process. But thank you all for committing. Thank you for being here. And thank you for saying yes. Okay, so there's these main myths that we tend to use as excuses. And a lot of us don't even realize we're using them as excuses in our job search. These are things that we've developed over time from people that have shared with us or just our own blockages that tend to develop over time throughout our career. Because we haven't taken a class in terms of, well, you know, this is how you go find your next dream job, your next job. I mean, we don't even have how to get a job offered as a class in college and such. So it's not surprising that these myths can develop over time. So the main one that I see, and hence kind of the subtitle of today's workshop, is that it doesn't matter how far you are in your career. It is never too late. So your career is only over when you decide it is. And I don't need to talk about this a lot if I'm going to actually go through these pretty quickly, but I want you to make a note of them if they resonate with you. There are so many examples of people coming into their dream job, right? People that have changed the world, 60 and up. 70 and up, 80 and up. And if you look at a lot of these examples here, Vera Wang entered fashion at 40, Donald Fisher, the gap at 40, Ray Kroc, McDonald's at 52. These are historic examples. So, you know, the 50 and 60 then was a much higher age at that point in time. It is absolutely never too late to change your career. And so if you're using that as an excuse, let's just get it off the table right now. That's a myth. That is completely a myth. I mean, there's even some statistics that show that the majority of income you're going to earn is going to be 50 and up, 45 and up. So are you ready to make a change? Because you can. It's never too late. The next myth, and if these resonate with you, throw it in the chat, by the way, please. Is that I've done this for so long. It's that I've done this for too long. I can't waste all the time and energy and effort that I've invested in my career. I don't want to start over. We've gone through school. We went through high school for 4 years, went to college maybe for 4 years for some of us. We've been in relationships for maybe 5 to 10 years. We've had jobs in the past maybe for 2 to 5 years. Do we stay in those? And so the time investment doesn't matter. It could be 5, 10, 20 years. The amount you've invested in something has given you skills, has created experiences for you, has provided income for yourself. But that is the past. So what can we take from there? How can we take the benefits of those experiences and use them for our future? How can we leverage them in a pivot? The past should not dictate your future. If it does, you're living in the past and not the present. So if you're telling yourself this, that I've done this for so long, I cannot change, then you're not living in today. And please remember that you go through many phases in life, and everything that has been in the past is part of the phase. So let's try to focus on the future. The next myth is I can only do dot, dot, dot. There's a lot of research out there in career development that highlights that we're really bad at knowing what options are available to us and really bad at evaluating options that we know of. Everything that you've experienced up to this point is influencing how you think about opportunities and influencing what opportunities you think are available. There's literally an infinite amount of doors available to you in the world for your career. And so we need to start questioning your beliefs and start exploring, we're going to talk about this later, people and resources. Everything you've learned in the past, you know, building off of the last myth, is a skill that you have learned, is a skill that you now have, that can be applied to anything. And so someone may see this, and I see it in the chat, that if there's an infinite amount of doors, I'm frozen. I don't know what to pick. And that's okay. That is okay, because part of the search is exploring some of the doors. You're not going to be able to explore all of them, to be honest. And that's okay. Part of this is accepting the fact that there are going to be doors that you close to choose to open other doors. And what doors you choose comes from your prioritization of options, things you enjoy. We'll talk about that list later on. But to accept that there is an abundance in the world and there's not a scarcity of positions that you could apply for is an important belief to have. And, you know, actually, I used to play soccer in college, and our goalkeeper graduated. He wanted to go pro and didn't make it, but he really wanted to be an athlete. He wanted to do something active. So what did he do? He tried out and joined the American bobsled team. I was like, how did this come up for you? Where did that come? But he looked at his options that were available to him that are outside his current options, but aligned with some of the interests that he had for himself in terms of where he wanted to spend his time, what energized him, and found an opportunity. Didn't think of that himself, but someone actually gave him that option and gave him that information that this was a possibility. So if we question our beliefs and go exploring, we can find out which doors are potentially there for us. Okay, two more myths left. This one is I'll just know. This is the one I hear the most. This holds a lot of people back. And I promise you, that's the majority of the time, you can't figure out what you're going to be good at before you do it. You can have this idea of where you might, and you know, where you might enjoy spending your time, but your gut and that instinct doesn't really have enough information. And you sitting in a room on your own reflecting is also good, but can lead to inaction and really isn't enough. Assessments, completely unreliable. You can, for every research study that shows an assessment is reliable, you'll find another one that isn't. It will limit you, will put you in a box, and then you'll be limited by that box in terms of what options are potentially available to you. And because there are a plethora of options, there's always going to be more and more doors to potentially open. It's going to be very difficult for you to say, I know with 100% certainty, just by sitting in a room and reflecting, that this is where you want to go. And so this requires more information. When you're going to explore your career, your dream job, You're not going to find it in an assessment. I'm sorry, you're not going to find it in this workshop. You're going to find it in exploration. You need more information. And so I ask you too, could you have predicted where you are today, 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago, without having the experiences that you've had, without going to work, without going to have a conversation with someone, without traveling somewhere new? And so experiences are key here. Trying is key. And the last but not least, and this is the most prevalent one, and I want to cross out every time I see this quote hit mainstream, is that it won't feel like work. Let's be true. I have my dream job. It still feels like work. There are still days that I wake up and have to find the motivation. There are still days that I need to take off because I'm exhausted. And so we need to reset our expectations. So a lot of these myths are leading to inaction. A lot of these myths prevent us from going to try. So if we don't feel something is the love of our life, we might not invest in it. What I'm telling you, let's reset those expectations. We can make the most out of work, but it still will be work. It shouldn't be negative. You shouldn't have resentment towards it, which can be an actual consequence of burnout, by the way. So it might not be the work. It might be the amount of investment that you've made into that work without feeling recognized, without feeling a payoff. But ultimately, research shows that our jobs just have to be 20% fulfilling. That if 20% of our job fills our heart, we can find passion in it, we can find value in it, then that is enough for us. So ask yourself, what does work really need to do for you financially, personally, what skills you need to learn? This goes into the sweet spot that we're going to talk about in a little bit. A job can always be made into a better job through job crafting. So we can make work not feel like work most of the time, but right off the bat, it might still feel like work. So which of these myths are holding you back? And can we try to accept some new beliefs? Can we accept that it's not too late? Can we say that life is constant change, that doesn't matter what we've done in the past, we want to live in the future, that we're going to use that to learn something new, to create challenge and novelty and opportunity and apply our skills to what we've done to something else, that we know we have to explore. We're not going to find the answers just by reflecting ourselves and in a room or in an assessment. And that work may feel like work, but it can become more through our own actions, through our own shifts in our perception, through finding value in the work itself. So it might not start off as something that we love, but it can become something that we love. And every now and then I'll look over to the chat and I'll see a question or two. Sorry for missing some of them, but the 20% fulfillment comes from. So check out Marcus Buckingham. He's a researcher that is, I think his company got purchased by Stanford. He created Gallup, the Strengths Finders. And he's been doing a lot of the cutting edge research in job satisfaction. Okay, so we have this information. Hopefully, maybe we're planted the seeds of some new beliefs and we're watering them. I know I can't expect everyone to believe these right away, but please make note of them. What do we do with this information? How do we actually take action to go towards our dream job? We're in this mindset of trying. We're in this mindset of exploring. We're in this mindset of, okay, I'm not going to find the answers in myself. I'm going to find them from other people. But we do have good information from our past experiences. So how do we take all that together and use it to find this next job in our career? And so this is an area that tends to be overlooked. So our non-negotiables for work. You know, when we're in the job search, we're like, well, what company do I want to work for? What values, what I want to be doing? Well, we forget that, okay, there are some non-negotiables that are important for us. You know, what sort of work-life balance do you want? What type of culture do you want to work for? How much do you need to be paid? Yeah, that's a fair question. That should actually be one of the leading indicators in your job search. Even if you're like, I don't really care how much, great, that's an indicator. Write that down. Do you want to work remotely? Do you want to work in an office? Do you want to work hybrid? What sort of diversity do you want? What sort of values do you want from your organization? Now, these are your non-negotiables. Make a list, prioritize them, right? Maybe 5 to 10, maybe it's 1 to 3, depending on what you're open to and not open to, but lead your job search with this information. So you're looking for your dream job. Let's get the hard stuff down first, because this is going to dictate what you accept in it for an interview, what you apply for, what you describe to people in terms of what you're looking for. So if you have some of these, throw them in the chat. What are your thoughts? And I would highly recommend you don't just say, well, anything. Well, if you have a focus, if you have some specifics that you're looking for, that is going to incredibly help your job search for yourself, as well as other people that you share what you're looking for to. Okay, so mark this down, put it right, non-negotiables, put a big circle around it. We're going to move on. Okay, now we get into the career sweet spot. These are parts of what you need from a job that all come together to form where you should potentially go next. It's not going to tell you the job title. It could hint at it. It's not going to tell you the organization that you're going to want to work for. It could hint at it, but it's going to be the information that you use to describe yourself to other people, as well as what you look for in a job coming up, that is going to ensure that you have the foundation, the ingredients to make your next job your dream job. So this first piece is what you've been trained to do. These are your skills. It's not what industry you've been in, even though that is some information. It's more so what you've learned. Like, for example, I've been in training and development now for a while. I've been coaching for a while. That means I'm really good at listening, active listening. I'm good at guiding. I'm good at leading, good at facilitation. Potentially, I'm okay at slide decks. So these are the skills. These are the intricacies within the larger things that you're doing. And I've edited a lot of resumes in the past, by the way. People are pretty bad at this in terms of they can say a very high level of what they've done in terms of maybe a result of a project that they've had, but they tend to overlook all the things that go into that project. Because this is what you're really good at. And what you're really good at, it's really hard to identify the parts of it. So for example, I managed a project. Well, what does that involve? Coordination of multiple stakeholders, communication cascades and varied aspects of communication, crucial conversations, accountability and deliverables. These are pieces of project management that are important that can't be transferred into another job. So think about your schooling, think about the skills you've learned, and really try to identify your top 20 skills. Really examine where you've excelled in your career. When we're able to apply our skills to a position, right? One, it helps us understand where we want to go at work, but it also gives us more confidence in ourselves and make sure that we feel comfortable in the place that we're working at. Next piece is what you want to learn. So this helps you feel like you're progressing in your career. You feel that you're challenged. You feel that you're growing. And there's two components of this. One of it is what skills and challenges and experiences you want from work in the future. So where do you want to develop? What is that next step? A lot of times I work with clients that want to be promoted, but they have no idea why they want to be promoted. Usually, you know, there is some financial backing there, but there also are some things that you want to learn. Now, if you want more responsibility, what does that really mean? What does more responsibility mean for you? What are you learning based on that responsibility? So think about where you want to be challenged. A lot of times people look for a new job or feel stuck because they don't feel like they're growing. They don't feel challenged. They don't have that level of novelty. And so you can create this again anywhere. At any job, if the opportunity is there for you, and if you feel comfortable going to your leader and asking about this, or finding a position that potentially stretches some of your skills. Building on this same area of your career sweet spot is who you want to learn from. So it could be an industry that you want to be exposed to. I'm really into the psychedelic therapeutic space. So I've been talking to a lot of CEOs and executives in that industry because I want to learn how they operate. I also, wanted to get involved in the CPG space, super into health and wellness, and make sure that I intentionally reached out to those individuals. And now I've built up a community in Austin where I've been mentoring for an organization called SKU. And then directly puts me in front of people that are leading in the consumer packaged goods focused on the health and wellness space. So if you know who you want to learn from industries to coworkers, departments, to projects, that some people are working on, you then can start crafting your career, crafting your actions and intentions to put you in front of those people. And with enough time, energy, and being vocal about what you're interested in, it will work out for you in that way. So this is a critical piece of your career sweet spot. Who do you want to learn from? The next piece, this other circle within the career sweet spot, is about passion and purpose and meaning. And so what do you love to do at work? So again, write these down, put these big headers. I know I'm going pretty fast, but these are very important areas for you to explore. So what do you love to do at work? So think about 3 to 5 moments where you felt successful, proud, accomplished, or happy at work, projects you've worked on, results that you've had, times you've been recognized, things that have created joy. Maybe you haven't felt this in a while if you're feeling stuck. But what were the, who were the people involved? What are the tasks you were doing? Where were you working even? Were you remote? Were you in person? And what were the skills and the values that really created those moments for you? What you love to do at work is an important piece, but it's one of many. And I see a lot of people tend to focus heavily on this piece. We can create love through our perception of our work. If we are working in a place that aligns with our skills and helps us feel challenged. So again, this is just a component. But so where have you felt happy? I've worked with a lot of clients who had a really hard time with this question. When was the last time I felt happy at work or in a state of flow? And so you can go all the way back. You can rewind history if you need to find these moments, but hopefully they're there. And if they're not there, then we got to start crafting some of them. I'd want you to actually wake up tomorrow or even today and say, what's one thing I can do today that brings me joy? And then, okay, great. That's still something that you did. And that's something we can add to this plethora of information that we're now building about ourselves. Building on what you love to do at work is what you love to do in your life. Now, what we love to do in our life can be hobbies, they're things that we invest in, but there's sometimes foundational pieces within them that we can pull into our job. So for example, a lot of people say, I love to travel. Okay, well, let's get more specific. That's a trend, right? Getting more specific. What do you love about travel? Where do you like to go? How do you like to travel? What brings you joy about travel? And so, for example, I enjoy new experiences and novelty, so I can build that into my work. I enjoy adventure and fun and creativity, so I can build that into my work. I like doing things, kind of like rolling up my sleeves, staying in hostels, backpacking, and so I can pull that into my work in terms of how I like to work. So what you love to do in life can actually hint at how you like to work or how can bring more joy into work. So reflect on when you felt like you've had purpose or made an impact. And if you can't think of any, let's focus on the states and memories where you've been the happiest or you felt the flow. And remember, we only need 20% of our jobs to fall into this category to really feel fulfilled. But we can also change our perception about our work to relate to what we love to do in life. Like, for example, I like to volunteer. I like to help people grow. Now, luckily, I like to do that at my job too. But in life, I mentor a lot. I volunteer a lot. And so what aspect of my job can I create that helps me feel that I do the same thing? And so other than, of course, that I coach, when I work internally, I volunteer my time, I have office hours, and I offer coaching to our leadership as well as throughout the organization. Okay, so write this down, what you love to do in life, put a big circle of it, like just the other ones, and focus on a little bit more later, because I want everyone to spend some time writing at least 5 things under each of these categories. Because this all will come together and develop your career sweet spot. So it relates to skills, which brings you confidence, relates to challenge, which helps you feel like you're making progress. And there's that social aspect too, right? Because it's who you want to work with. And then the passion, which brings the meaning. So these come together where you feel confident, you feel challenged, and you feel meaning from your work. This will create fulfillment. And if you want a fun little activity, you can actually reflect back on, you can start today and go backwards in time and say, when was I on the sweet spot? When did I feel these 3 things? And you'll see a trend of when you were happy and when you were dissatisfied. And so we can actually say, okay, I'm going to reapply my skills to what I'm doing today to actually utilize what I'm good at. I'm going to adjust my work to focus on what I'm good at. You can say, I'm going to change my perception of my work and reconnect to the meaning and start focusing on things that I truly care about and realize that what I'm doing today does have an impact. And I'm going to set a goal each week to do something that challenges me, to either meet with someone that I really respect in my organization or outside of my organization, or I'm going to get involved part of the time on a project that stretches my skill sets. I'm going to go find one. And so you can do this today, but also when you're looking for your next job and when you're in interviews, you can ask questions that say, you know, well, you can ask them about the values of the job. You can ask them about what projects are upcoming for the role. You can ask them about who you mainly are going to work with or the career backgrounds of the people that you might work with. You can ask them about the actual role itself to explore what skills are going to be applied within that role. And you can ask them if there are certain things you can do that you found out that you love. So not only can you use this to adjust your job, but you can use it to craft interview questions as well as to find your next job to ensure that it falls into the sweet spot. And if you have answers to these questions, you can also create an elevator pitch. For example, hey, my name is Dr. Benjamin Ritter. I care deeply about helping others find a career that they can love, unlocking their professional superpowers. I really enjoy facilitating, teaching, coaching one-on-one. I find a lot of joy from really listening to others and helping guide them towards their paths, as well as helping organizations become a place where people can do that. My next steps, I'm really interested in creating a scalable coaching program within an organization. And I'm looking to find people that have done that or people in organizations that are currently doing that. And so right now I've created an elevator pitch that if I go share that with anyone on a call or online through LinkedIn networking, where they can say, I know what Ben does and I know what Ben's looking for. And so now all of a sudden I've created a path towards my dream job. It's a lot to take in. Pause for a moment. Now I'm going pretty quick, but I want to leave some time for questions. So in review, what comes to mind when I discuss the career sweet spot? When I discuss these multiple categories of where we can find fulfillment in your career and in your job? Are you leaning towards a specific title? Are you leaning towards a specific organization? Have you said, well, I can actually adjust what I'm currently doing for work right now? What we're doing is we're building basically kind of this brand of who you are, what you've done, and where you want to go. And that brand does take a little bit of work to build, but it can be critical in you actually finding your next job and creating a job that brings you joy. So I see people typing right now. Give everyone a second. And I'm also just going to touch on something that gets in the way as people are typing of people finding their next job. They tend to look at a job description. This is a little tip for people looking for a job right now. They tend to look at a job description and disqualify themselves from actually applying to that job based on the details in the role itself. I would highly suggest if you're looking for a job right now and you're using job boards or applications that I think should just be about 15 to 20% of your time, that do not even read the description. Make sure it's in the location that you want it to be and make sure the job title is something that relates to your skills. Make sure it's an organization you could find joy working for and apply. Most of the time, people disqualify themselves from opportunities. And I'd say, let's keep the doors open. Okay, we got a lot coming in right now. So let's see, high quality, meaningful cultural production, exercise genuine confidence in your past. There might have to trade off some tangible returns for intangible returns. That is true. Sometimes we do make sacrifices, but if those sacrifices are a choice and we feel that we have control over them, then they still can bring us joy. I like to say, well, what is possible? How do I get the tangible and intangible, the external and the extrinsic and intrinsic all at once? Because that is something that you can create for yourself. Remember, there are an infinite amount of doors and possibilities. A company will hire you for the thing you want to do for the amount you want to make. And if it's not true, maybe you can find a job doing what you love and turn it inside an organization and make up the rest doing something you love for a part-time job or a contracting position or a business that you create. Okay, change career, we'll need to invest in classes. Now, if you look at how long it's taken you to create the career that you have today, if you look at a 3 to 10 year window to change your career, let's say you need certifications or there isn't a way for you changing industries completely, changing jobs completely, that is an acceptable path forward. If you're making that a choice, you can still find joy in that transition today. How do you make life work for you? We're pretty resilient into people. We usually can make things work for us. And I'd say always question what you think is the only path because there's an infinite amount of them. But if you make a choice, that can still bring fulfillment. But the longer you wait to make that choice, the longer it's going to take to actually create the kind of end goal that you're looking for. And to share too, we think that there's an end goal, but when it comes to our career, we're doing it for a reason. We do it to find joy. We do it to make money usually. And so you can find joy at any moment in time, in any part in your career, even if you're learning and building your career, and you can make money in a variety of ways. Let's not limit what we think is possible. Okay. Just looking through some of these. Thank you all for sharing. I'm going to look at more of these later as well. Hopefully some of these answers are helping everyone as well in this event. More creative work that brings surprises every day. And for someone that's saying, you know, I want a job that is more creative. Yeah, that could be a new job. Very much so. It could be an organization that values creativity more. But I'd say in the meantime, while you're looking, can you go create more, right? Be more innovative and more creative where you're at today? What if you did something a little bit differently? What if you talked to someone that is the creative person in your organization? What if you worked on a new different types of project? Just some ideas. Okay, so thank you, everyone. I see the words still coming in. The phrases still coming in. I appreciate that. I'll look at these more later too. So what do we do now? We have our sweet spot. We have a list. Maybe you'll have a list later. We have all the doors are open to us because we're not holding ourselves back from these myths. Well, this is where that extreme try piece comes in. So now you're going to make a list of potential job titles and you're going to go explore potential other job titles and talk to other people. And also you're going to make a list of industries that you might be interested in. You're going to rank your options initially. So I actually love everyone to take a screenshot of this. You can send this in the follow-up potentially to take a screenshot of this, write these down, because this is important. You're going to do your initial research after you rank your options. And that research is very high level. So you're reading about the industries, the job titles you're interested in. You are, you know, maybe listening to podcasts, maybe watching an intro video. You are maybe finding someone that does the job and asking them in your current network. You're doing your initial research. Based on that initial research, you should be able to update your rankings and say, okay, I don't really want to be in this industry or that industry, but this industry seems really cool. I think these jobs actually sound something like I'd like to explore a little bit more. They relate to where I've been, but also are different to where I want to go and do kind of fall into this sweet spot for the next step as well as for the future. So you update those rankings. This is where you now do a little bit of deeper research. So I'd say heavily network in terms of reaching out to people that are currently in this space and just being curious. You're not looking for a job yet. You're learning. So you're saying, hey, your career path, really interesting. I've done a lot of work. I think I want to go in here. I feel like I'm completely transferable into this space if it's a complete pivot. I would love 20 minutes of your time to learn more about what you do. Once you have a couple conversations and you figure out this is where you want to go, this is where you look for quick projects. You can volunteer. You can shadow. You can get a contract role. You can, someone that you've networked with, you can ask if you could help them out on something for just like a month, a couple of weeks, maybe something quicker than that. This is going to give you a taste of the actual job. And then when you get that taste, you can then update your rankings and then say, okay, I want to try a longer term project. I'm going to work on something for 6 months to a year. I'm going to go work on a job for a year and a half to 2 years. It's interesting that I'm saying that because some people say like, well, I do something for 2 years and then stop doing it. Well, that's okay. It's literally just 2 years. Like if you plot out a career path for yourself and say, is it worth, if I'm interested in this position, I've done the research to know I'm interested in it. I've done a quick project and quick win. I know I'm interested in that. I've connected with people and built a community around myself, around this industry. I'm interested enough to go invest a little bit of my time. And then throughout this process, you're saying, am I still in my career sweet spot? Six months in, am I still in my career sweet spot? 12 months in, am I still in my career sweet spot? 2 years in, am I still in my career sweet spot? If not, you can make adjustments. So this is where that try piece comes in. Again, you're not going to figure out your dream job sitting at home doing a self-assessment. You're going to figure it out getting some initial information and going exploring. So I have to reiterate again, you have to explore. So compile your list of non-negotiables. That's most important. Put together your list for your sweet spot and then go start having conversations. And remember that if you're planning on making a move, this move is going to impact your life in a positively significant way. It's going to be filled with new experiences. It's going to create new relationships. And ultimately, we're doing this to have fun. Everything in our life, we wake up and say, if we're just under a load of stress, if we feel like the weight of the world is on our shoulders, then we have to admit we're doing something wrong. Because other than just choosing to work to make money, to put a roof over our head, after that's done, it really is to have fun. And so are you having fun? And how do you craft a world to have fun? How do you use these, even this time of exploration, as a time in your life where you can create connections, learn new things, and remember to enjoy it. You won't discover your dream job by dreaming. So please go out there, jump on a sled, get your favorite stuffed animal, and start exploring. And if you're listening to this and you don't see the slide, it's Kelvin and Hobbes. It's one of my favorites. So we're going to move into questions pretty quickly. I want to give everyone some time for questions. But prior to that, we're going to do a quick giveaway. So everything I talked about today can be used in a job search strategy. So you can go out there, how to make connections, how to leverage your brand, how to discuss your elevator pitch, and how to use that, not just to get information, but to get a job. So real quick, moving on to Slido. This is completely anonymous. No one can see it. Submit your email for a chance to win a free job search strategy session. I will be reaching out to a certain individual that wins. I'll pick their email out. And just for anonymous purposes, I'm not going to announce it on the workshop today. But this is a chance for you to win a free job search strategy session with me. I have other content out there. If you liked what you heard and you want to learn more, you can always do that. You can always contact me on LinkedIn, continue the conversation, explore coaching opportunities. But ultimately, I like to give back a little bit to basically help someone in their job search. And depending on the amount of entries, I may pick three people. So the more people that enter, the more people that have a chance to win. So give everyone a second. If you so you'd submit through Slido, so you can use the QR code currently on the chat window right now. Please don't put your emails in the chat. For privacy reasons, you can go to slido.com, type in the event code DREAMJOB, and that will enter you into the raffle. So I'll keep that up for a second, and then I'll turn it over to questions and answers. So Alexa, how do we do that? Should I open up the Word document?
Yeah, feel free to open it up. They've been okay.
My Alexa just went on.
Oh God. Yeah. I should change my name. The Slido link is in chat for those who missed. And Shira, the recording is shared for 72 hours after the field trip.
Okay. And so thank you everyone too. I know I went pretty fast through that content. And so I appreciate you listening, appreciate you being here, appreciate your focus. And let's take some of these questions before we have to jump off for today. Okay, so looking at, should I start at the top or is the top the old ones and the bottom new ones?
It's all chronological.
Okay. So starting on the top, one of the designers I look up to takes a sabbatical every 7 years to search and explore new practices. I've taken a year-long break and found it very helpful. Find the time to explore and play. What is your perspective on taking self-imposed breaks? There are very few times in our life where we are forced to grow. Any time that we have an impact to our routine is an opportunity. So if you think about it, graduating, moving, end of a relationship, new job. And so a forced sabbatical, not forced, but a self-imposed sabbatical would create growth. I mean, just because it's a change in your routine, it's a change in everything that you're currently doing at that point in time. So I'd say if you have that opportunity, feel free. You can even do that yourself through actually taking your PTO, which a lot of people don't do because they're so attached to work. Kudos to anyone that feels comfortable taking a year-long sabbatical and being able to drop, you know, to have that level of mindset and attachment to their work and to their career. I think I'd be curious if this is in the States or in another country. I know in the States, it's a little bit, people tend to have a different mindset around work, but I would say that it would be pretty powerful to do this for yourself. So probably talk about this for a while, but I think hopefully that adds some value. Hopefully it answers the question. We can also take this kind of to a daily perspective and give yourself breaks on kind of each and every single day or once a week, where you take a day off every 2 weeks or you don't have any meetings Monday mornings. Like for example, my Mondays till about noon, I usually leave pretty open. My Fridays after a certain time as well. So I create self-imposed breaks throughout the days to allow myself to do the things that I love. I will also try to not have meetings early because I like to do yoga, I like to go for runs, I like to work out. And that's a way for me to ensure that I refresh my batteries, which are really important because the moment your batteries run out is the moment where everything tends to be more stressful, where you feel like you're in the wrong place, where you end up getting to the point of burnout, where even the things that you love don't matter anymore. Okay, next question. How do we bust the myth in our colleagues' mind? So you learn this as a coach, you can't coach people that don't want to be coached. And you can't change people's perspectives that don't want to be changed. What you can do is live as you want them to live in a way. Like, for example, I wake up and I live a certain day by my values. That impacts people around me, even the slightest way, just to come into contact with me. So if there's something that you want to bust in a colleague's mind, you can recommend a podcast. You can recommend the recording of this and say that you got a ton of value out of it. Don't say, I think you need to listen to this. You say, I got a ton of value out of this. If the title interests you, check it out. These are the top three things that I've learned. And so by making suggestions that are about you and living the life that you want to live, that you would hope that they can learn from, that's a way to kind of rub off a little bit in a way that is not going to impact their ego or be seen as kind of intrusion on their personal space, personal professional space. Okay. Next question. How would you help guide potential employers in an interview to believe these big possibilities alongside us rather than staying in limiting their beliefs? Yeah. Again, we can't change people, but what we can do is choose where we go next. And so if you are in an interview with an employer, ask questions that relate to your sweet spot. Ask questions that relate to the job crafting. For example, if something you say is, if I'm in this position and I feel that there's a better way or different way that I'd like to do this job, is that possible? And they say, well, can you tell us an example? Well, then give them an example. Or for example, if you have different ways that you like to work in terms of the days and times, you can ask them, what sort of level of freedom do you have when it comes to the times you need me to be available? This is the way that I prefer to work. And so you can create a job that works for you if you're willing to choose an employer to work for, as well as you can't create something if you don't bring it up. So a lot of times I work with clients that don't get the feedback that they want from their leaders or don't get actions taken on their career development plans from their leadership. Well, I, you know, directly ask them, so what have you done to make this possible? Have you asked for feedback? Have you held them accountable to being put on certain projects or being evaluated at the next level? And a lot of times the answer is no. And so how can you lead yourself in your career and help the organizations create a job that suits you best? Okay. So what if we find the intersection of all these things, but there's not a job there? Like no one is going to pay me for this or it's super competitive. Yeah, this is the scarcity mindset. Is there a job out there? Or I can't, why would anyone choose me? And what I asked in the beginning and I'm going to ask again now is, can we look at our job search through a lens of abundance? And you see this mindset that actually impacts relationships. It impacts money where, you know, we feel that we're not good enough and we feel that there's not enough of it in the world. And I promise you, you are good enough. Someone will pay you for that. And there is a job out there that could relate to what you care about. I can't share like all the job titles that I've seen created or the work that I've seen done, because some of it is a little explicit, but it's like the possibilities, some of the things that the people are making money off of right now blow me away. Even I was amazed by it. But if someone has the belief and can go work towards finding the companies that do it, the people that are interested in it, or potentially doing it yourself, because if you want it, somebody else probably wants it. You can make that happen for yourself if you choose to make it happen for yourself. Now, it may take time. So let's drop our expectations in terms of how long this might take for us and then try to invest in certain things that are going to build skills or build a community that are going to help us reach our end goal, because our career is a career. It's a path. It is not a point in time. And so a multiple jobs could lead to that final job. So if we have that mindset, then we can literally make anything happen. Okay, so how do we deal with imposter syndrome when we delve into our skills? I often feel like I'm not good at anything, even if I actually know it's not true. We are our worst enemies. We are our greatest critic. And so for this, I'd say, let's look outside of ourselves. We can step outside of ourselves and evaluate ourselves as somebody else, as a different persona, which is something we can do, kind of disassociate. But what I would also recommend is to go to your leader, get direct feedback, go to previous leaders, get direct feedback, go to your coworkers, go to peers. What are the top three words that come to mind when you think of me? What are my top three strengths that you perceive? Go back in time, look at the projects that were wins, go to the people that were on those projects, ask the same questions. So basically you're collating a list of positivity as well as successes that you then can use to be your best champion. And you're going to need that on your job search anyways. But imposter syndrome is very real. I have the three C's of self-leadership. I work with my clients. One of them is confidence. And it is a journey to become confident. It doesn't happen overnight. It is constantly reiterating the things that are great about yourself, constantly creating proof about what's great about yourself. Because if you have imposter syndrome, if you do feel that your inner critic is louder and the greatest voice within you, then we have to slowly take away its microphone and slowly yell back at it until the voice of our inner champion is louder. And that is a journey in itself. And the best thing you can do is get rid of negative people around you, spend time with more positivity, and constantly reflect and affirm your wins and your successes and your strengths on a daily basis. So hopefully that helps. I feel a real pull to do what the world needs, possibly at the expense of what I want. Have you helped anyone find this balance? The feelings of guilt and shame on what I should do and what I want to do are real. They're very, very real. And this is where you need to really sit back and build a list of the reasons why you feel pulled towards something. When it comes to our career, we're influenced by the stories that we've learned over our life. I mentioned this earlier, from our parents, from the media, from our peers, from ourselves. And those stories are not real. They're just stories that we've chosen to focus on. And so if you want to change that story, you have to understand what new story you want to create and create more motivation and interest in that story than in the past. This may mean having to disconnect from people in your life. It may mean exploring where these stories came from and why you feel it's important. It may require that you deal with the guilt and shame and pressure and detaching from that until your new story becomes routine and becomes part of who you are. Disconnecting from the past is disconnecting. It's detaching. And it doesn't, again, going back to this idea that it's a journey and it's a progress. So to both of these previous comments, you know, it is stressful and is it a strain? And I appreciate you being here and trying to move forward in both of these areas. I would highly suggest focusing on where you're spending your time and who you're spending your time with, because it's very difficult to do these things alone. And so trying to find a community that relates to what you're trying to achieve will be very helpful. What if you don't meet the education requirements? Many companies use filters that remove anyone that doesn't have a specific degree. Very true. Very true. I've worked with clients that don't have, don't have a bachelor's degree, don't have an associate's or anything of the sort. And sadly, these companies have put a flag in the sand to say what their values are and what they want. And so you may have to use a filter criteria for that education requirement or apply and let them filter you out on their own. I've known some companies that have changed their education requirements based on candidates that they've had. So I'd say find a company that wants you to work for them because that's who you want to work for. And they let them disqualify you. Okay, by not reading job description, what should I say in the cover letter? And so what I mean by not reading the job description is to not allow the job description to disqualify you. So when you create a cover letter, it really should have multiple components, an intro paragraph that says, you know, the position, the organization, and the main keywords in terms of why you qualify. So those usually can be found in the job description. The next two paragraphs should highlight projects that relate to the job itself, that also, you know, utilize keywords within the job description or general job descriptions that relate to the job titles. This should be easy because you should be applying to similar job titles. So then if you can collate those job descriptions, look at 3 to 5 of them, pull out the main keywords, and then you can input them in your cover letter, then you'll qualify basically for multiple different positions that you're interested in. And then the summary paragraph will basically just be reiterating your interest in the role. So it's not reading the job description. It's not allowing the job description to disqualify you. Just looking at the time, I know we have about 2 minutes left. I have a hard stop. And so I just want to pause here and as I'm just going and going and going, say thank you to absolutely everyone that joined us here today. If you'd like, please connect with me on LinkedIn. Say dream job, say that you found me through this field trip. If you do that, there's a, we can offer a discount on a resume, LinkedIn, or job search strategy package. So usually I think I offer about 20% to people that attend events. So that is available to everyone that attended today. But most importantly, please try. Please take the time after today and continue trying, continue that commitment. Commitments do create change. If you wake up each and every single day with an intention towards finding your dream job, towards exploring, towards having fun, and utilizing the information that you know about yourself to see a world of possibilities and opportunity, no matter how long it takes. Remember, it took me almost 3 years to get my next job. It took me, over 3 years to make my pivot. If you can see those possibilities for yourself, then it will happen. And if you are working towards something that is going to take, 3, 5, 10 years, remember that even in 10 years from now, if you're not happy today, you're not going to be happy then. So let's focus on trying to create that positivity and the outlook on life that really brings us joy right now in the second. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Ben. Really lovely to have you. Reminder for y'all, if you want to save the chat, you can do that with the triple dots in the right-hand corner. Another reminder is that feedback is extremely helpful for us and for our hosts. It's a way that you can give back to them so we can all continue to grow. And then lastly, if you would like to say your own thanks all at once, this is your opposite. This is like a vocal confetti for the host. So first we did our visible one, and now I invite you. Vocal confetti.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. We've got more field trips coming up tomorrow. This is the last for the day. I'm sharing the link for the survey again in the chat, and you'll also get it in the 24-hour follow-up email. So Benjamin, thank you so much. We are closing up in 3, 2, 1.